sports fans. Coach Nick here, and welcome to B-Ball Breakdown. I want to do a preview of the NBA Finals for you, and let's start with the Heat offense. You might remember in the beginning of the year, I was brutal on them because it was a mismatch of all sorts of different kind of offensive schemes, and it was a mess. They couldn't figure out how to get LeBron James and Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh to play together. Well, I got to give kudos to Eric Spoelstra because they figured it out with his double high post series. They run it the majority of the time, and what they figured out was if they could put Dwayne Wade in the weak side corner and have him come around screens, that's going to be the engine that starts everything else and gets everyone else great shots. And while it took them a long time to figure out, by now it's making their offense hum along pretty well, and they're getting the shots they need to put them in contention to win this championship. A new wrinkle in the Heat offense is Anthony getting the ball on the wing. This is all a precursor to posting up LeBron James. However, Deng takes the pass away, and where the Heat are very dangerous is that Noah had to come over to help on James, but that leaves Bosh open to do some serious damage from the high post. Another bread-and-butter play for the Heat offense is the double screen down for Wade out of the corner. There's the two screens. They play it well, though, and as he swings it to Bosh, watch how he gives up on the play. He just starts walking around, not ready for the ball. So now, when he gets the ball back, he is not in position to score, and they have to burp up a bad shot. There are times LeBron will be the point guard and go screen in the corner. This time it's for Wade, a very dangerous proposition. However, Bosh throws the ball away. Another example of LeBron screening in the corner yields a flex-type offense where he screens and then gets a screen in the weak side, pops up, wide open three. Very dangerous as well. And another clever play, they screen for Bosh to get the high post pass from LeBron. LeBron will go screen in the corner on the strong side for Wade. Now you have the top three players on the same side working a three-man game. Screen and roll, pick and pop, and there's Bosh with the open jumper. Watch how LeBron screens down and then will screen across, all another prelude to posting him up on the block. Great stuff. Watch Haslam back screening for Miller in the corner, so they're looking for a double team, and when it comes, they can get the shot open in the corner. In certain situations, like at the end of a quarter, LeBron or Wade will both bring the ball up and just ISO to score. Notice how there's no real post move here. Just lower the shoulder, turn around, and shoot and hope for the best. Another example of an ISO when he brings the ball up deep in the fourth quarter. There's no inside-out dribble, no crossover, just lower the shoulder, hope to get something, almost travels, and somehow is bailed out with a foul. And there are times when Wade will bring the ball up himself and just get a quick pick and go attack the basket and score. Where Wade helps LeBron is when he brings the ball up, everyone is so focused on him, they tend to forget that there's LeBron James, a really good three-point shooter, spotting up on the weak side. Let's go to defense. The best thing that the Heat did against the Bulls defensively was to take them out of their pick-and-roll schemes by aggressively double-teaming the ball. Well, I'm sure we all understand now that Dallas is a whole different animal compared to the Bulls. They have a lot more lethal weapons across the board, and if you want to load up on the point guard like that, you're going to be in for a world of trouble. The hedge is Anthony on this screen and roll, and watch how he's able to keep Rose under control, and as he comes around, funnel him toward the baseline where there's Bosh waiting to block the shot. If Anthony's not careful on that hedge, Barea or Jason Terry can split that screen and roll hedge and get to the basket and get a good shot for a teammate. And that ain't going to be Kurt Thomas shooting, it's going to be Nowitzki. Watch what Haslam brings them that they didn't have before. He can hedge on the screen and roll and keep Rose under control out of the lane until Wade can get back. They rotate really well, and then again they do another screen and roll, and there's Haslam again to hedge. Again, keeping Rose in front of him and making him burp up a bad shot. So it's not just Anthony and Haslam doing a great job. Bosh can also hedge and keep the fastest player in the NBA under control. When they rotate and get the bad shot, watch how fast they are in transition. This is what really hurts the other team. What hurt the Bulls was the Heat's aggressive double teaming on the pick and roll. Here's what happens on this. They hit the high post, you get a 3-on-2. But now imagine that one on top is Dirk Nowitzki. You have Chandler and you have Peja or Jason Terry in the corner shooting that three. Whole different ball game, wouldn't you say? Let's move on to the Dallas defense, specifically the 2-3 zone they employ, which serves as a great way to protect some of their weaker defensive players and other players who simply don't match up physically with the Miami Heat. They do some really great stuff with their rotations in that zone, and I'm going to show you what they do for that. Really cool. However, Oklahoma City did not have that much trouble scoring efficiently against it, and I want you to picture Chris Bosh out there doing his thing. Nobody on the Thunder had any kind of game like Bosh in the front court, and so I think that the 2-3 zone will be marginalized as the Miami Heat will pick it apart by getting Bosh the ball in the high post. In this Mavericks zone, they love to push up as high as they can with the center coming up above the free throw line. That makes them vulnerable near the basket, but you have Chandler, a great shot blocker, to help out and affect those shots. By pushing up so high and spreading your defense out so thin, you're vulnerable to offensive rebounds like this long rebound. Back in their set, watch Chandler and how high he's willing to come out, basically becoming another guard, and that's going to give mismatches for Dallas. But here's where their defense gets really cool. Watch how Dirk Nowitzki is going to rotate over with the cutter, Harden, and that makes Stevenson bump up to the guard, and then Terry drops down. The Heat can try and pin Jason Terry down on the weak side and score the bigger man. But watch how Tyson Chandler, for some reason, waves Stevenson off and plays the guard spot, giving them a mismatch that Harden takes advantage of. Here's an example of where that rotation can get very screwy and cost them wide open shots. When the ball gets brought over, Sean Marion bumps up, but Jason Terry doesn't go back down. Now you got a 3-2 defense instead of a 2-3, leaving the corner wide open. And that's not going to be Westbrook, it's going to be Wade in the corner. Setting a high screen on that guard will also make them vulnerable to kickouts for all the shooters that Miami have. If the Heat can clear off the corner on Dirk's side, luring him into coming up to the wing, they can isolate against him with a guard, blow by him, and get the kind of penetration that will kill this zone. And let's talk a little bit about the Dallas offense. While we all know that Dirk Nowitzki is their main option and their number one alpha dog go-to guy, you have to watch the pick and roll when he is screening or when he's not screening, either way. And this is going to be one of the keys to who wins the series, is who can execute better either the Dallas offense on the screen and roll, particularly with Barea, or do the Miami Heat hedge correctly and rotate better where they don't get good shots. J.J. Barea is one of the catalysts, and if you want to go underneath the screen, he can kill you by pulling up and hitting that wide open three. The Mavs love to send Dirk to screen the ball, and he's very tricky. Here he slips the screen before there's any contact and now gets the ball to the baseline and a layup. Again, watch how he slips this high ball screen here, getting right to the basket. He's big enough and quick enough to get there and finish with contact. When they screen the ball with Chandler, watch Nowitzki at the high post, very close to the ball. When everybody collapses, he's wide open for an easy pass and a nice jump shot. We know the Heat will be much better on their hedges than Kevin Durant is here, so you have to watch out that Barea can't cross over and get into the lane for an easy layup. However, even with good hedging, Barea is quick enough to get around the outside. Once he turns into the lane with a crossover, forget about it. He'll make a good decision and they'll get a good shot. So while the execution of offense and defense is obviously important, I think of what's more important is the chess match between Spoelstra and Carlisle regarding the lineups. I think the challenge is going to be to get a lineup out there for either team that gives them the most advantage. It could be a small lineup and a crazy weird stuff, but whoever is quicker at figuring out which of those lineups works for them is going to win this series. So there's going to be a chess match of moving it around and trying to figure out who is doing what and how against certain players. And once that riddle is solved, and you really almost can't prepare for it ahead of time, but once it's solved and the other coach can't adjust, that's going to decide the series. Again, if the Heat have a lead going into the fourth quarter, I don't see how they're going to be able to stop Wade and LeBron James enough to win those games. But that said, if Dallas is able to control the game at all going deeper into the fourth quarter, then they could give it to Nowitzki and cause the same kind of problems. So while I originally thought the Heat in six, it's certainly conceivable that Carlisle will come upon a lineup, and I think that Barea will be a big key in that lineup, that gives the Heat so much trouble that they can't overcome it and the Dallas Mavericks can win this series, most likely in seven games. Well, stay tuned for lots more on B-Ball Breakdown. will be coming to you from Hawaii on a little vacation I'm going on. So it might look a little different, but the content's the same and the same quality breakdowns. So thanks for joining us. Stay tuned for lots more. And don't forget, it's not a channel, it's a conversation. You win?